Mr. Kill by Martin Limón. Narrated by Peter Berkrot. Chapter 1. Hot metal shrieked as the Blue Train Express from Pusan braked its way into the vast yard of Seoul Yok, the downtown Seoul railroad station. Someone barked an order. Two squads of khaki-clad Korean National Policemen fanned out along the cement platform, prowling like shadows through roiling clouds of vapor. "Whoever this guy is," Ernie told me, "GI or not, he's about to be introduced to a whole world of butt kick." "My name is George Sueño. I'm an investigator for the Criminal Investigation Division of the 8th United States Army in Seoul, Republic of Korea. My partner, Ernie Bascom, and I stood with our backs against brick, waiting in this overcast afternoon for the arrival of a train that, according to railroad authorities, held tragedy. The Blue Train engineer radioed ahead that a female passenger in car number 3 had been threatened with a knife and raped. She was found by one of the stewardesses cowering in the lavatory, too incoherent to give much information, but claiming that the perpetrator had been a Kochengji, a big nose, in other words, a foreigner. In the early 70s, what with 700,000 fire-breathing communist soldiers on the far side of the DMZ, just 30 miles north of here, there weren't many tourists in the Republic of Korea, nor were there many European businessmen, and only a smattering of diplomats. The foreigners most likely to be using the Blue Train on this Monday morning were Miguks, Americans. And those Americans were most likely to be among the 50,000 or so GIs who fell under the jurisdiction of the 8th United States Army. Therefore, the call had been made by the Korea National Police to us, the agents of 8th Army CID. Exactly who this guy was, we didn't know. All we knew for sure was that the crime had been committed somewhere after the Blue Train pulled out of Daejeon. Between there and here, no stops. The Blue Line takes about 4 hours and 50 minutes total to travel the almost 400 kilometers from Pusan to Seoul, with only two brief layovers, the first at the East Daegu station and the second at Daejeon. At each scheduled stop, the train pauses for less than 5 minutes. After leaving Daejeon, whoever perpetrated this crime would have had no way to get off the train. Therefore, we were assuming, as were all these Korean cops, that he was still aboard. Lieutenant Shin, the officer in charge of the KNP detail, told me that the engineer had further explained that the victim was a young mother with two children in tow. Apparently, she'd left her son and her daughter in their seats while she used the bathroom. That's where she'd been assaulted. The rapist forced his way into the small bathroom behind her and threatened her with a knife, slicing the flesh of her throat superficially. The blood and the blade had convinced her to comply with what he demanded. Everything he demanded. The cops in Lieutenant Chin's detail already knew that a woman with children had been assaulted by someone they assumed to be an American GI. They weren't happy about such a non-Confucian crime being committed in broad daylight in a public place, and they allowed their anger to show when they glared at Ernie and at me, as if we were somehow responsible. Steam puffed from the sides of the train. With a huge sigh, the big engine shut down. Usually, even before wheels stop rolling, people would already be hopping off metal steps, hurrying to beat the crowd filtering toward the front gate of the main station. Today, eerily, nobody moved. If I hadn't been able to make out seated silhouettes through the fog-smudged windows, I would have thought it was a train full of ghosts. Lieutenant Shin barked more orders, and two cops took up positions at the end of each passenger car. Other cops covered the opposite side of the train. Thus surrounded, all possibility of escape was eliminated. Behind us on the overhead ramparts, a crowd gathered, people waiting for other trains. Some of the civilians murmured loudly about Miguk Nom, base American louts. Somehow they'd gotten wind of what had happened. Accompanied by Lieutenant Shin, Ernie and I climbed aboard the first passenger car. The head conductor, wearing a high-collared black coat and pillbox...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.